love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like it. You shall love your neighbour as yourself. On these two commandments depend all the law and the prophets.
Lord, have mercy on us, and grant these your laws in our hearts.
God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to intercede for us in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. Shall we be seated now? Let's confess our sins, impenitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments, to live in love and peace. Almighty God. Power of love, that as we rejoice in their triumphs, We may be sustained by their example and fellowship. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Please be seated. Heather's going to bring us silence.
The first reading is Joshua 3:7-17. And the Lord said to Joshua, "Today I will begin to exalt you in the eyes of all Israel, so they may know that I am with you as I was with Moses. Tell the priests to carry the ark of the covenant. When you reach the edge of the Jordan's waters, go and stand in the river." Joshua said to the Israelites, "Come here and listen to the words of the Lord your God. This is how you will know that the living God is among you, and that he will certainly drive out before you the Canaanites, Hittites, Hivites, Perizzites, Girgashites, Amorites, and Jebusites. See the ark of the covenant of the Lord of all the earth will go into the Jordan ahead of you. Now then, choose 12 men from the tribes of Israel, one from each tribe. And as soon as the priests who carry the ark from the tribes of Israel, one from each tribe. And as soon as the priests who carry the ark of the Lord of all the earth, set foot in the Jordan, its waters flowing downstream will be cut off and stand up in a heap. So when the people broke camp to cross the Jordan, the priests carrying the ark of the covenant went ahead of them. Now the Jordan is at the flood stage all during harvest. Yet as soon as the priests who carried the ark reached the Jordan and their feet touched the water's edge, the water from upstream stopped flowing. It piled up in a heap a great distance away at a town called Adam in the vicinity of Zarephath, while the water flowing down to the sea of the Arabah, that is the Dead Sea, was completely cut off. So the people crossed over opposite Jericho. The priests who carried the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord stopped in the middle of the Jordan and stood on dry ground, while all Israel passed by until the whole nation had completed the crossing on dry ground. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you very much, Heather. You nailed this part of Israel music. So shall we stand to sing our next hymn through all the changing seasons of life?
Thank you.
Hear the gospel of our Saviour Christ according to Matthew chapter 21, beginning at the 23rd verse.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Then Jesus said to the crowd and his disciples, "The teachers of the law and the Pharisees sit in Moses' seat, so you must be careful to do everything they tell you, but do not do what they do, for they do not practice what they preach. They tie up heavy, cumbersome loads and put them on other people's shoulders, but they themselves are not willing to lift a finger to move them. Everything they do is done for people to see. They have their phylacteries wide and their tassels on their garments long. They love the place of honour at the banquets and the most important seats in the synagogue. They love to be greeted with respect in the marketplace and be called rabbi by others. But you are not to be called rabbi, for you have one teacher and you are all brothers. And do not call anyone on earth father, for you have one father and he is in heaven. Nor are you to be called instructors, for you have one instructor, the Messiah. The greatest among you will be your servant. For those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
I speak in the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Good morning to you.
Good morning.
In our reading from Joshua this morning of a wonderful historical account of a people's relationship with God and of their total trust in Joshua as God's servant. But what do we know about Joshua? What does the Bible tell us? Joshua is a minor figure in the Pentateuch, the first five books of the Bible. He was born in Egypt and he was named Hosea, son of Nun from the tribe of Ephraim. But Moses renamed him Joshua. And he was one of the 12 spies of Israel that Moses sent out to explore the land of Canaan. And as we hear about him in a few passages also, he was Moses' assistant. He accompanied Moses partway up Mount Sinai when he went to retrieve the Ten Commandments. But more importantly, he was his assistant in the Tent of Meeting. Now, the Tent of Meeting was a tent that was put up every time they camped somewhere else. That was the first tent to go up, and it was a Tent of Meeting, a tent where Moses went to meet with God. And interestingly enough, we're told that when Moses left the Tent of Meeting, Joshua remained in it. He remained there. And funny that that picks up that wee detail. Joshua wanted to remain in God's presence. And I believe that in that time when he remained with God in the tent, that God prepared him for what was to come and equipped him to deal with it. He knew God. He knew the supernatural power and presence of God in that tent, and he had faith in him and his promises. And so when the time came after the death of Moses, Joshua was the choice, wasn't he? He was chosen by God to lead the tribes of Israel into the promised land, to conquest Canaan and allocate the land to the tribes. Now, according to chronology of the Bible, Joshua lived between 1450 to 1370 BC, and he died at the age of 110. Now, the first thing that you probably think of when you think about Joshua is when the walls came tumbling down, Joshua at the Battle of Jericho. That was, in fact, his first battle after they crossed the River Jordan. Now the Israelites had waited a long, long time for this crossing, and they were at last crossing into the Promised Land, the land flowing with milk and honey. And, you know, they'd spent many hard years wandering in the desert, 40 years in fact. Nowadays when we say about
crossing the Jordan into the promised land. We're talking about eternity, aren't we? We get that. So I think Elvis Presley saw about crossing the Jordan into the promised land. Now God had made the promise of this land firstly to Abraham and to Isaac and to Jacob. And it is the place in which Moses spoke as he led the people out of Egypt. And remember, they had a river to cross at that point as well. So as Caleb and the others spied out this land for Moses, they came back and they reported to him it was not only a rich land, it was a really blessed, fertile land, but it was already occupied by giants and warriors who weren't keen to give that land up. So they knew that a battle on their hands. But all of whom would be overcome with God's help, so that the people could live in peace and enjoy the blessing of that land. And I think we all long for this kind of place in our lives, don't we? The place where enemies are overcome, that enemy that's always negative, the enemy. A place where all of those enemies are overcome by the power of God. And a place of abundance where our needs, physical, emotional and spiritual, are met. A place where the fear of the wilderness we often find ourselves in is replaced by joy and celebration of a life lived in a place like we imagine the Garden of Eden, like paradise. But this is God's promise to us. He promises us just such a way of life, and he guides us towards it and shows us the way to enter it. But when I read those words, I can hear Thomas saying to me, "But we do not know where you're going, Lord, so how can we know the way?" And I remember Jesus' reply, "I am the way and the truth and the life." Christ has made the same promise to all who believe in him, to cross into that land, that promised land. And it's not only for eternity, but now, because he said, "I've come that you might have life and have it abundantly now." So today in our reading, we see Joshua, we see that final stage of the people's wandering in the wilderness, the stage where they're finally called into that land, and we see them cross through the Jordan and into the land of promise. And the details of that story are helpful to us for our own journey. So let's sort of have a look at those details. First, we must understand about the River Jordan. It was the largest river in the region. There were no bridges across it. It was like the king's highway from Egypt to the Euphrates, from the land of the Pharaohs to the land of Assyria and of Babylon. No bridges or crossings, but sometimes at certain times it was a little bit lower and people could get across as long as they didn't mind getting their feet wet. But crossing a river, even when you have a bridge, represents quite an event in life. I'm sure you've crossed many rivers and you kind of would stop in the middle of the on the bridge and look. And you're always a bit anxious to get from one side of it to the other. Rivers can be a big obstacle to the traveller. And the symbol of crossing the river, crossing the bridge, it's really deeply embedded in our faith, I think, because we look at the cross itself, and it is seen as a bridge. The cross is a bridge between earth and heaven, a bridge we cross. Now the River Jordan on that appointed day that we heard about must have seemed like a giant impediment to their moving into the promised land, you know? An impossible task. Perhaps a few might survive, maybe they thought they'd lose a lot of people, a frightening prospect. One thing to put your foot into a gentle stream, maybe you know, go up to your knees and wade across, but another to go into those roaring flood waters, which is what the Jordan was like that day, as we're told in our reading. And remember, this was all new to the people. This was a new place. They didn't know this river. They didn't know this area. But Joshua and the leaders of the people tell the people that they're to enter the promised land by following the priests. Now, the priests were carrying the Ark of the Covenant, and you remember what that looks like. And it was the sign and symbol of God's presence with them. They were carrying the ark into the middle of the river, and then the people would pass by. And that the river would part for them at that time. It sort of made me think, I'm sure you know John Ortberg's book, If You Want to Walk on Water, You've Got to Get Out of the Boat. It was significant that one step into the roaring water had to be taken before those waters parted. It was when the soles of the feet of those bearing the ark touched the water that the waters began to part, not before. So it was about faith. About faith. Listen to it from verse 15. As soon as the feet of the priest touched the water, the river stopped flowing and the water started piling up at the town of Adam near Cherith. No water flowed toward the Dead Sea, and the priest stood in the middle of the dry riverbed near Jericho while everyone else crossed over. They had to put their feet into the water before the waters divided. And in the faith journey, there comes times when it looks like you're backed up against a barrier, a river flood state, a promised land on the other side of that raging river. And as followers of Christ, as a people who have been promised a new land and a new life, we're called to step out in faith, to make that step, before the circumstances seem to be ready, so that we may enter into that land, that we experience that life. We're called to cross the river, to enter the turbulent and muddy flood waters, so that we might receive the fullness of what God has promised to us and all who follow that. And it's a frightening prospect, isn't it? But we, like the people of Israel, have God with us. And as we step out, we carry God with us, as we hold in our hearts the precious name of Jesus, as we trust in God's living presence, even though the circumstances don't appear to favour us, we trust that those waters will part. And I'm sure, like myself, you sometimes stand on a roaring riverbank and you teeter on the edge of reason. How am I going to get through this one? And I know, personally, I shouldn't be surprised, but sometimes I'm just blown away by God's provision for me, by God's intervention into these troubling times. So what today's story tells us, with its mention of how the priests carried God's presence, the ark, into the river, is that God always goes before us. God is always there, preparing the way. God knows the big picture. He's in control. He goes before us into the floodwaters of life. God stands in the middle of those murderous waters, and God watches us pass safely to the other side. Sometimes we lose sight of that as we try to battle through in our own strength. This story that we've read is a story of salvation. Salvation of a people. And we'll be praying for that salvation to come again in our prayers this morning. It affirms God's love. It affirms God's love for you. And He will not let anything stand in the way of His love and salvation for you. This is a story that's worth telling, isn't it? It's also a lesson for us. Joshua was prepared. Prepared by spending time with God in that tent of meeting. He knew God, knew His power, and his faith was grounded in that knowledge of knowing Him. So don't be afraid when it seems that the tumultuous waters of life are going to wash you away. Just take that plunge and step out in faith. Get your feet wet in the knowledge that just as He did for the children of Israel, He will do it for you. He'll bring you safely to the other side, to the land and to the life that He has promised to all who follow. And this is the message of the gospel that we proclaim. So let us pray. Father, we read in our Bible stories of trust, faith, and courage. Help us today to read and learn that we too might step out with confidence into the future, in the knowledge of your power, your love, and your mercy. Lord, in your mercy.
Thank you, Carol. Shall we all stand now? We're going to affirm our faith in the words of Nicene. We believe in one God.
We believe in one God, the Father and the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, of one being of the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who went with the Father and the Son and is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge all baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
So let us pray. We have sort of been shocked over this last month by what we've seen on our television screens about the conflict in Israel and Gaza. So we're going to spend some time this morning just concentrating our prayers on that conflict, just praying for God to move and intervene. And I'm just going to be using some material provided by Tear Fund to help us do that. So shall we just pray together now? Pray particularly for God to intervene in that conflict. First of all, Lord, we pray for peace. We do pray that a ceasefire would come and that the violence would end. We pray for world leaders with influence in the region to be able to make wise decisions that will lead to lasting peace. We pray that God's peace would fill the hearts of one and minds of everyone who is suffering as a result of this conflict. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for safety for all civilians, that God would protect them from harm, particularly the most vulnerable, including children, older people, people with disabilities. We pray for humanitarian workers, the protection for those who are working to provide assistance and medical supplies. We pray for safe access to food, water, medical supplies, fuel, and electricity. We pray for all those who have been forced to flee their homes, praying for safe places for them to stay, and that eventually they'll be able to return back to their homes. Lord, in your mercy, we pray now for strength. Pray for church leaders that they would have that wisdom and strength to lead people through the fear and uncertainty. Pray for bravery for them as they guide their communities and offer loving support. We do pray for Christian communities and faith leaders across the region, for unity, connection, and mutual understanding, so that they can help to bring people together and show kindness. We pray for strength for the humanitarian workers, that God would strengthen their resolve and ability to provide that relief and assistance. Lord, be Lord.
And
we pray now for hope. We pray for those who are terrified, mourning, and suffering in Israel and Gaza. We ask God to save them from despair, for the trauma and violence they've experienced not to overshadow their hope. And we pray that people in Gaza, Israel, and those in the wider region wouldn't lose hope that peace is possible. For with God, all things are possible. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
And finally, we do pray for healing. We pray for people who have been traumatized or injured. We ask God to heal their physical and emotional wounds and bring them deep comfort. We pray for hospitals and medical workers who are struggling with limited resources and overwhelming need. Please provide all the resources and equipment they need to treat the sick and the injured. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
And Heavenly Father, we do ask that you would stretch out your mighty hand to bring an end to this war. We do cry out to you for the people who have been injured or traumatized, who have lost loved ones or families. We do pray that your peace would eventually reign. And we look to you as our Saviour and the hope of the world. Lord, in your mercy. As we continue in prayer, we want to hold before you now those that we know in our own circles, in our own community, who are sick, those maybe in hospital or at home, who are struggling at this moment. We can pray particularly for Nell McQueen in hospital at the moment. And in the silence, let's now just hold before God any others known to us who need that healing touch from him today. We also pray for those who have been recently bereaved, to remember particularly today the families of John Gamble and Betty Connolly, whose funerals were held this week. We do pray for all those who will attend our memorial service this evening, that it would be a help and a comfort to those who attend. Merciful Father,
merciful
Father, accept these our prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ.
Amen.
As we pray, prepare to come to communion, we pray together in the prayer of humble access. We do not presume. We do not presume to come to this church table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your love. Part of our service, we stand, stay down and sing together now. We come as guests in the right kingdom.
Thanks, he broke it
And he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And after supper, he took the cup, and again, giving you thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Drink from this, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." So, Father, with this bread and this cup, we do as our Saviour has commanded. We celebrate the redemption that he's won for us. We proclaim his perfect sacrifice, made once for all upon the cross, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension. And we look for his coming to fulfill all things according to your will. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Renew us by your Holy Spirit. Unite us in the body of your Son, and bring us with all your people into the joy of your eternal kingdom. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, with whom and in whom, by the power of the Holy Spirit, we worship you, Father Almighty, in songs of never-ending praise.
Blessing and honor and glory are
and yours. Saviour Christ has taught us with all to say, those who have funerals through our ministry here this year. Please come along to welcome people, or come along yourself if you'd like to remember the loved ones. We're going to be taking a list at the back of church as people arrive, just to remember those they'd like to remember. And we're looking for a bit of help. We actually need one person to help Jim to do that at the back of church this evening. Also, I've said to you, it's actually three people to do short readings tonight. If you think you could help, please just have a chat with me on the way out. Monday night is our bowling and table tennis evening in the church hall. And Tuesday we have our coffee morning. It happens once a month now in person. So please come and join us for that. And the select vestry is in the evening. Wednesday is our community friendship club, and we have a speaker coming to share about the needs of refugees and asylum seekers in our own community here in Newton Abbey. It's actually been really fascinating. Please come along and join us if you haven't been before. It's a great fun afternoon. And our faith shared final session is on in the evening at 7:30. Bowling knitting meal on Thursday, and also there's our nanny nursing home service. Again, if you'd like to come and join in with that and meet the residents and talk with them, just turn up at 1:45. Saturday is the annual Remembrance Day service in Lillian Lamb Park on Armistice Day itself. And the following week, the men's group is meeting on the Monday night to discuss the men's breakfast. Wednesday, the community friendship family group is getting together to plan for a Christmas party. Thursday we have an Abbey Nursing Home, Intercessors and Healing, as well as the bowling and the TV. And just two events that you'll see on the screen in front of you we're working towards this month. On Friday the 17th of November we have our sports quiz. Christians in Sport are coming again to lead that for us. We'd love to get word out around the community. As many people who won't come to church will very happily come to a sports quiz. So please, if you can just tell people and invite them. If anyone can put a poster up for me, there's a number of posters on the back table, please take that and just put it somewhere visible. We'd love to get the word around and just fill our hall for that sports quiz. And if you don't like sport, please come along anyway. There's an observation round where you can actually, if you've got no sporting knowledge, you can do very well on as well. But it'd be great if we could really fill the hall for that. And then the following Saturday, of course, is our Christmas craft fair. We've got 24 crafters coming for that. We're grateful for the donations of scones and tray legs. They probably should be bought rather than made, just for food hygiene reasons. If you can help with that, there's a list at the back of church for you to sign. And also, if you're willing to help just serve tea and coffee during the afternoon for a certain slot. Again, there's another list at the back you can sign for. And finally, we're offering prayer for healing after all our church services now. If anyone has a need for healing, either for themselves or someone they'd like to bring to God in prayer, members of our healing team are going to be at the front after the service, and they're very happy just to pray a short prayer with you. So please don't go home burdened. We can bring our concerns and our need for healing to God confidently. He hears those prayers and wants to work with them. So please just, if you want to come forward at the end of the service rather than going up, people come forward then and we'll be willing to pray for them. So shall we sing our final hymn now? Wednesday was All Saints Day, so we want to hear and we can finish with today. For all the saints in front of their neighbours.
Thank you.
So may God give you grace to follow his steps in faith, in hope, and in love. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit rest upon you and all those whom you love, and all those whom you remember, this day and forevermore.
Amen.
Go in peace to love, serve, and share the Lord.
In the name of Christ.
Thank you for being with us for our service of Holy Communion here at Carnmoney Parish Church this morning. Our first reading was read by Heather Seeds. Our Gospel reading was read by Rodgers Cairncross. The service was led by the Reverend Andy Heber. The Reverend Carol Harvey was our preacher. And Gordon Myers today was our organist. Thank you for being with us, and we hope you'll join us next week for our Remembrance Sunday service.